Hello everyone, I am Viraj Kamath, a generator for the Group 28. Our CL246 heat transfer project theme is cooling system in high processing CPUs. So to introduce our project theme, we all know that one of the most common issues that most users face while using computer systems is overheating. What we aim to do in our project is to take a small step towards finding a more efficient cooling mechanism among the more traditional air cooling and liquid cooling systems. And how do we manage to do this? We have tried to choose an appropriate system design and control volume, and by collecting all our known and unknown, we have tried to solve it by both assuming steady and transient state equations. We have also optimized the equations at the end for the best result. To know where we are heading towards, basically, we also conclude that the liquid cooling system is better than the air cooling systems. And apart from that, there is also a suspense which we have for you all, which we'll reveal at the end. The benefits of this research will be reflected obviously for the common man: lower electricity bills, fewer repairs, which obviously translate to lower repair and maintenance costs, as well as quieter operations while using the liquid and air cooling systems. For some background, we did our internal survey at the ground, and the results are not to our surprise that more than 56.4% people told that overheating was a major issue within 6 months of using. It's obvious due to the above given reasons. What's our literature inspiration? So we researched a lot using internet sources and trusted journals. And one of the main points which you got from this is the heat extracted is directly proportional to the computational power of the CPUs, which means that this will, using better cooling systems like liquid cooling systems here, will lead to substantial reduction of capital expenditure needed to meet such high-end computational requirements. This is reported in given in NASA's such journals, which you can be looked up later on. For the big picture, in layman terms, this is what we know, as you all might have seen this as game and gaming CPUs. They look very flashy, right? Yes, indeed they are. But please focus on these pipes and these fans instead of these snickering LEDs right now, because that's what is important for our project. These are the cooling systems, and we are going to study them in depth. And please don't let the lights distract you again. Heading on further, this is just a more scientific view per se of what happens inside with the liquid and with the cool and the hot assist heat flow mechanism shown, and the labeled diagram here. Handing it over to my friend Divyansh, who will explain the air cooling system.
So in the detailed analysis of an air cooling system, we see the zoomed in view, and we see that this is the heat generating device, that is, and all these arrows denote the heat transfer mechanism. The black arrows inside shows the conductive heat transfer to all the parts of the system, while the blue arrows are the convective heat transfer and the radiation heat transfer from the system to the surrounding. This is the zoomed in view of a 3D fin. So in this 3D fin, we can see the thickness, length, width. This is a duct through which the air flows. Seeing our control volume, so this is a small control volume where we have the heat generating device and the fins. And we know about the ambient air, its temperature, that's 25 degrees Celsius, air properties, dimensions, and all other knowns. Well, the unknown quantity here would be the heat extracted from this system. So our main focus would be to do test. The technical problem, in an exact word, we can say that the chip is mounted with a heat sink with fins made up of copper. And these fins are grid of 5x5, so total 25, of dimension 5x3x1. Cooling fan of diameter 10 centimeter and power rating 28 watt is just attached to the top of the fins here as a heat sink. And we need to study the relationship between the heat generated by the chip to the airflow conditions, keeping the temperature stagnant. So here temperature stagnant means we need to plot a diagram. So how can we increase the heat extraction while increasing the airflow condition, keeping the temperature stagnant? And these properties are given copper properties and air conditions. Assumptions and estimate. So the first is the size and property. We have taken the 120 mm chip which is usually used. The other variant in the markets are 80, 92, 140, and 200. The another big assumption that we have used is the fan power consumption, and velocity of air is linearly proportional to each other. So there are not many correlations, there are hard correlations found there, but in many practical purposes, even in industry, they use this assumption. So this certifies for that purpose. And the third is we keep the fan too close to the heat sink so that the velocity of air is uniform in the vicinity. We consider films to be ideally conductive and properties are assumed constant throughout the system. So this is our temperature profile. If this is from the temperature profile in the fin, we can be seen from the wall to the surface as like this. While this is the resistance network and expected temperature profile here. So this could be the, this is the heat that is produced. This is the chip in which heat is produced. This is the cold plate in connection. And this is the resistance of the fin and the heat is on and the temperature is consistently decreasing inside. So coming to the generic equation. So Q extracted will be the Q from extracted from system to surrounding. So it would be for convection and radiation. The convection we know formalize heat transfer coefficient into area into the surface temperature minus the surrounding temperature. And here, since we have n fins, so 2n surface area, so 2n is multiplied here. The another thing is the radiation loss that we have calculated. So for the considering the emissivity of copper plates 0.15 and putting all the values like hot plate temperature 50 degrees and ambient as 25 degrees, we get it around 0.956. And this is less than 1% of air cooling system. So this is very less and we tend to ignore the Q radiation in rest of our study, both in the liquid and the air cooling system. Using the further equations, we have the equations for Reynolds number, Prandtl number, and Nusselt number correlation, both for the laminar and turbulent flow, which we took from the textbook. Also, as stated in the assumption, we have taken the RPM, that's the velocity, is directly proportional to the power. And areas and surface areas can be calculated. And we solved it further, and we put in the code, and we got the values like Reynolds number, Nusselt number, and heat transfer coefficient, both for laminar and turbulent flows. And we plotted them. So we got we plotted the volume flow rate versus heat dissipation graph, both for laminar and turbulent. For those low volume flow rate laminar, 500 to 25, we got to some exponential graph. While for the turbulent, it was almost linear in this case. The caveats and improvement in the model. So we assume the ideal conditions and that could hurt because in real life, the ideality does not hold. Also, one of the assumptions that the fan was controlling the air velocity could not hold because some other factors can come into picture. And we have ignored the contact resistance for this, which can also affect our calculations. Next, we'll move to liquid cooling system, which will be done by Viraj.
So the liquid cooling system. Initially, let's start with a detailed analysis of our liquid cooling system. We know that it's a cycle, basically. So analyzing the cycle, we know that there is a water reservoir which sends water into the pump. The pump obviously will need to pump in water throughout the cycle. So that's the role of the pump, through which it goes to the water to air heat exchanger. Because the coolant inside will get hot after taking the heat from the chip, the heat will need to be taken out so that the water or the coolant comes back to its inlet temperature. So that's the role of this. And this is the area where the heat transfer occurs from the chip to the cold plate to the coolant. So yeah, this is a more detailed analysis view of the same. Moving on forward, the CV and the integral balances. Before solving anything, we need to know three things. The knowns, what is our control volume, and what's our unknown quantity. Pretty simple, right? So in our knowns, we have the cold plate temperature, which is assumed to be approximately 32 degrees Celsius as per renowned textbooks. And liquid properties, dimensions of cold plate, mass flow rate, maximum temperature liquid can reach, all of these are some things which we can control and we know it. Control volume. This is our control volume, which is the liquid flowing from in to out. That's the region where heat is actually getting exchanged. And we need to study upon it. The unknown quantity is obviously the heat extracted, because that's what our major focus of the project is, of how much heat is extracted and how good the system is able to extract heat. So yeah, this again is the same thing which I told, the heat from the chip gets transferred to the cold plate and through it gets transferred to the coolant. Technical problem. I'll not go into the intricacies of the technical problem. It basically says how the liquid heat is transferred from the chip to the liquid coolant through the cold plate and stuff, And because the cold plate has is assumed to be of aluminium or copper and has a very large area, it is assumed to have constant temperature. Some other values which we use, which are common in renowned journals and textbooks, are H is equal to 750 mm, 600 mm, and operating temperatures which maintain steady temperature of the cold plate at 32 degrees Celsius. The water inlet temperature is 7 degrees Celsius, which is also a renowned value by noticing on repeated journals. Assumptions and estimates. The assumptions, fairly simple, are listed in the above slide. These are the assumptions which we have used. Isothermal cold plate, the heat generated is dissipated only through the cold plate to the liquid. Circuit boards can be represented as isothermal, steady operation, constant properties, etc. This is a point which I would like to focus. We obviously know that the dependence will not be linear because we have complex equations. But we noticed that over a fair range of values, fitting it to a linear regression model gave us a very high R score, which shows that it was a decent approximation. Now, what's an R score? The model, a measure of how good the model is, how close the R score is to 1. So a 0.996 R score shows that our model was very good and it fitted to the real data very nice. Hence, our linear regression model was a decent approximation. Here is the approximate temperature profile, which will be in a decreasing fashion. Point to note is this qualitative and it's not exact. Equations. These are the equations which we have used. RE, Reynolds number, Prandtl number, new correlation, and these are the equations which you have studied in our course and also from the equations which are quite used, where Q dash is the heat extracted and T naught is the temperature of the coolant. So yeah, this is a snippet of the code which we have used and these are the values which you have got. Moving forward, what I told, the linear regression point, this, even though it's not a straight line, it is approximated to be a straight line over a decent range of values. Coming to the numerical analysis, we in our assumptions took the mass rate to be constant. What if we don't? We understood that by changing, we experimented a bit with the mass flow rates and we got to know that by taking it as a sinusoidal wave, the efficiency of cooling increases by a sizable amount. This, under these, the following assumptions, is a new type of thing for was a new type of thing for us, and we thought that instead of keeping it constant, we can instead vary the mass flow rate to with time as follows. Some of the caveats and improvements in the model, caveats are as follows. All the assumptions are caveats because they are far from reality. And the improvements are obviously not following the assumptions, such as not assuming cold plate temperature is constant, taking the fluid to be actually real and not non-Newtonian. Some of the heat generated by the chip is dissipated in air and other surrounding plastic and not just to the cold plate, etc. And also, we need to know that the regression analysis, we not use the regression analysis and use the actual data. That's also a point which will bring about improvements. Moving upon to the hybrid cooling model, which was the suspense factor at the start. This is a Brownian point which will be explained by my friend Divyansh.
In the hybrid cooling model, we have both the air and the cooling liquid cooling system. In this, the hot chip is generating air and the liquid is connected to the cold plate extracting the heat. Also, fins are connected and a fan is moving so that the heat can also be conducted from the fin. So we use both the air and liquid mechanism to extract heat, and this increases the power extraction power of the system. So now we talk about the cost and comfort effects of both these systems. So air cooling, it's cheaper, but it takes higher maintenance cost. It has low heat extraction capacity, as we saw and as we expected also, because air has less conductivity than the liquid. Consumes high space, definitely we need to put more fans and all. While in liquid case, the liquid cooling, higher energy efficiency, that is, it can extract higher, smaller footprint because it takes lower spaces and low noise pollution. It's expensive on the first part, but it's been seen in the report as seen by a Sheldon paper for cost analysis. It's 14% lower maintenance cost than air cooling when in the long terms. Also, the hybrid cooling we suggested, it will maximize the power extraction and optimize the cooling system, as we can optimally choose amount of air cooling and liquid cooling to be used. It has high establishment cost, definitely it has, but it has a low amortized cost. That is, over the time when we normalize it with the power that is extracted from the system, it will have comparatively very less cost compared to liquid or air cooling. So results. So main takeaway is that liquid cooling mechanism is better than the air cooling mechanism for cooling high processing CPUs. We also analyzed the dependency of mass flow rate variance on the cooling system, and we see if we increase the mass flow rate, vary the mass flow rate, we can increase the efficiency of the system. And we studied about the hybrid cooling method, and we have given a calculation and report. Like using both the air and liquid cooling system, we can increment almost around 25% of the liquid cooling system. What can be done in the future? Definitely, first of all, the model we have suggested, the hybrid heat transfer, we can do 3D simulation of it to get the temperature and heat transfer profiles. And then this system can be optimized for the trade-off between the power extracted and the cost. And again, comparing the component by component cost, we can do it. Like if we change the liquid system used in the cooling, we can get the better efficiency, and we can put it that way to optimize our cost and power extraction. So this is our team. Thank you.
Thank you.